So welcome again to our online service from Holy Trinity Tulse Hill. Back in the 8th to 6th century BCs, with the rise of great new empires all across the Middle East, the Jewish people were dispersed and taken as slaves, some just exiled, all over the Mediterranean world. And they called this the diaspora. And although some came back in the 6th century BC and following, and rebuilt the temple there, for most of them, they stayed where they were. So the temple became a symbol of their unity and somewhere that they aspired to visit through pilgrimages and so on for the great festivals. When Herod rebuilt the temple to its massive proportions in about 20 BC, this sense of the temple holding so much together was all the more important. Well, as we continue in our series on the letter to the Hebrews, we can well imagine the Christians in these places around the Mediterranean, particularly in Rome, where the letter was written, having been expelled from the local mainstream synagogues into their little churches and feeling rather sorry for themselves because they were now cut off, as it were, from that great culture that centered on the temple. But as we'll see today, the writer to the Hebrews says, no, we have a great high priest. And in fact, we have a temple that is even more ancient and more venerable than those that you see in bricks and mortar. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, at this time when we are separated through the coronavirus from our church building, we thank you that we are joined together by your Spirit, and I pray that we will know your presence as we join in with this service today. In Jesus' name, amen.
The reading is from Hebrews chapter 8, verses 1 to 6. Jesus, our high priest. The whole point of what we are saying is that we have such a high priest who sits at the right of the throne of the divine majesty in heaven. He serves as high priest in the most holy place, that is, in the real tent which was put up by the Lord, not by human hands. Every high priest is appointed to present offerings and animal sacrifices to God, and so our high priest must also have something to offer. If he were on earth, he would not be a priest at all, since there are priests who offer the gifts required by the Jewish law. The work they do as priests is really only a copy and a shadow of what is in heaven. It is the same as it was with Moses when he was about to build the sacred tent. God said to him, "Be sure to make everything according to the pattern you were shown on the mountain." But now, Jesus has been given priestly work which is superior to theirs, just as the covenant which is arranged between God and his people is a better one, because it is based on promises of better things. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So when was the last time you spoke to an estate agent? Maybe you went to try to rent out a flat, or maybe you were trying to buy somewhere, or maybe you were even letting property. Estate agents, as we all know, have their own special way of speaking, don't they? It's part refurbished, they say, meaning that the previous owner lost the will to live halfway through. Or easy access to motorways and public transport links, meaning that you have to have earplugs in the whole time. Realistically priced, meaning exorbitantly priced. Deceptively spacious, meaning blatantly small. Garden mostly laid to lawn, meaning rubble and shopping trolleys also feature there. Well, the letter to the Hebrews could be said to be a little bit like that. The writer knows that at first glance, what the Christians have looks risible. Let's just remind ourselves that throughout the Roman Empire and throughout the Gentile world around the Mediterranean, they were a vulnerable sect, broken away from what was also a minority ethnic population. And this minority population, yes, they were protected in law, but they could be despised in practice, and the Christians were an offshoot of them. In Judea itself, they were actively persecuted by the mainstream majority. And for that reason, in order to build them up, our writer says the equivalent of has great potential, when actually what you can see is a sinkhole in the garden, or fantastic fresh air, meaning badly fitted windows, or glorious views, meaning the roof hasn't been built yet. This week, our writer says, yes, he may have died. Yes, Jesus died. Okay, don't worry about it. Actually, we have a great high priest. Yes, there may be no earthly building. Yes, we know you can see that. But actually, we have the greatest heavenly temple. Yes, we may be cut off from our heritage, but actually, we have a brand new covenant with God. So those are my three headings today. A great high priest. We'll think a little bit more about that. We've been thinking about it already. A heavenly temple. We'll think a little bit about that. And a new covenant. Alexander Nairn, the great Nairn, as I called him all those years ago in my dissertation on Hebrews, the great Nairn, making him sound like a Scottish seabird of note. Alexander Nairn called Hebrews the epistle of priesthood. All the way through, our writer explores this theme, right from the beginning, right to the end. And I think he probably thought about it as he heard Psalm 110 being read in church meetings, or maybe being recited in church meetings, or maybe it was in the form of songs, we don't know. But that psalm was around everywhere, and I'm sure that it inspired our writer to really think about Jesus and his priesthood. He's already considered the order of Jesus' priesthood in the line of Melchizedek, the order of Melchizedek, and how this was in fact a superior order than the order of the Levites, which was the mainstream Jewish order. He's considered Jesus as the ideal or the beloved priest, and we looked at that a few weeks back, how tenderly he relates to the community around him. Now he's going to consider Jesus the priest before the altar, Jesus the priest in the holiest place, Jesus the priest offering the sacrifice. That's his focus on for this chapter. Now, we have to remember that in Judaism, the Levitical priests in the first century were highly visible, either in the flesh, because you lived in Jerusalem, or in the imagination, depending on where in the Mediterranean world you lived. This is one of the reasons why we can actually date Hebrews to the early 60s AD, because the temple was destroyed and the priesthood decimated in AD 66 by the Romans. Clearly, when our letter was written, everything was still in place. Now, if you didn't live near the temple, and of course the Jews were scattered all around the Mediterranean world, so if you didn't live near the temple, then it was your ambition to go there on a pilgrimage to one of the high days or holidays. Stories would abound among pilgrims returning from Jerusalem of the temple's size, the stream of animals carried in for sacrifice, the many priests around all keeping themselves busy. The early Christians, as a newly founded, tiny branch of religion, were cut off from all of that. The Jerusalem priesthood had actually orchestrated the execution of the Christian's Messiah. So listen now to what the writer says in verse 1 of chapter 8. He says, the whole point of what we are saying is that we have such a high priest. So everyone knew they didn't have any priests. And he says, the whole point of what we're saying is that we have such a high priest. Now, listen, when I was about 19 and still living at home, my father had a Hungarian boyhood friend to stay. He was a very confident man, almost a brash sort of person, very post-war atheist, you might say. And when we were alone, he asked me, so tell me, Richard, what are you going to do with the rest of your life? And I was a little bit nervous of this chap. I said, oh, I want to go into the ministry, I said, my bundle of nerves waiting for mockery. Oh, how interesting, he replied. Which one? I thought, what do you mean, which one? It's obvious which one. I didn't say that. I said, what do you mean, which one? He said, well, do you mean the Ministry of Defence, the Ministry of Housing, Ministry of Health? And so with even greater embarrassment, I had to explain that I meant the church. I'd been so careful not to use the word priest because I didn't want him to think I meant a Catholic priest. And also I'd been so careful because I really believed that Jesus was our only priest. I was so hung up with the careful use of language. I used language in the end that he had no understanding of, so I had to explain it to him. Now, the reason why I'm telling you that is the thing is that when we read Hebrews, there's loads of language to do with priesthood that may seem foreign or obscure to us. But to the first listeners of this letter, they knew exactly what the writer was going on about, because priests and all they did were key to their culture, especially if they were Jews, but even if they were Gentiles, they had priests and temples and altars. For example, the priests in Jerusalem were there serving on a rota. That's what they did. You didn't have priests that were there all the time. The maximum length of priest might be a year. The high priest was appointed for a year. Generally, the other priests who went in and out were there on a rota system. They only went into the temple when their turn came up and they'd go from their priestly estates wherever they lived. So you'd hear them say things like, oh, I'm sorry I can't be at the bagel eating contest this weekend as I have to serve in the temple. But Shem, it's an honour to serve in the temple. Yes, but I was looking forward to seeing that girl, Rebecca. I've heard her bagels are uniquely soft and I'm considering her as a wife. Well, obviously that is a completely fictitious conversation, but you can imagine the sort of thing, going to serve at the priestly rota. Was their way of life. The work of the priest and this rota system was common knowledge. But here in verse 2 of Hebrews chapter 8, the writer says of Jesus, he serves as high priest in the most holy place. Not he serves on occasion, or he serves on a rota, or he serves when his time comes up. He serves all the time, permanently, eternally, perpetually. He doesn't go there on a rota basis when his turn comes up. As the writer says back in verse 1, he has, to read it literally, taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of the divine majesty in heaven. He has sat down, he has taken the seat that has his name on it. The writer goes on in verse 3, every high priest is appointed to present offerings and animal sacrifices to God, and so our high priest must have something to offer also. And in fact, he also made the same point back in chapter 1, verse 3, where he said, having made purification for sins, he sat down on the right hand of God. Having made purification for sins. In other words, having offered the sacrifice. So, as our great high priest, the sacrifice that Jesus offers on our behalf is the sacrifice of his life on the cross. He's made that sacrifice now. It's done. And he presents it permanently in heaven. Have you noticed, I don't know if you've bought any software recently, maybe you've noticed that you get these licenses, don't you? You can have a renewable license. You pay so much every year, a subscription. Or you can get what they call a perpetual license, a license in perpetuity. And I'm thinking, well, if I get a perpetual license, does it continue after I die? What is this word perpetual? A license, a perpetual license. That's what you can buy. Jesus is perpetually our high priest, forever and ever, not on a rota, not when his turn comes up, not going up to Jerusalem to serve when it's time, but there in the holiest place in heaven all the time, forever, presenting that sacrifice that has been made only once. So the manner in which he is priest is similar to an earthly priest, but the quality of his sacrifice is far superior because it only needed to happen once. And the quality of his presenting that sacrifice is vastly superior because it is permanent and perpetual and eternal. Well, in part two, we'll think about the heavenly temple.
As you bring us to this fellowship, Jesus, we pray that we will be thoroughly exercised in light. That we will do faith, we will do hope, we will do charity, and we will move into God. Cast these words to mix with blood in me. Let it become my reality. Take my mortality from me. Father, cause this word to be the life I live. I will do faith, hope, and charity till Christ is all that's left of me. Singing glory, honor, power, and salvation to Jesus, high priest of good, good things to come. I love this part. We will be thoroughly exercised in all that we are hearing till we become just like. Come on, make a joyful noise to him. Hallelujah. Hey! Priest. pray. Jesus the high priest.
Jesus the high priest.
Of good, good things to come. Tending to God, Jesus the High, of good, good things to come.
So let's talk about the temple. As I've said before, the earthly temple comprised a series of courts, the outer courts, the inner courts, the holy places, and right in the center, the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. And in this sense, the temple was a symbolic building. It wasn't just functional, it was highly symbolic in the way that it was laid out. And only the high priest once a year could go right into the Holy of Holies. Just like in the wilderness, only Moses could meet with God face to face in the tent of meeting. Now, I began this sermon with some estate agent speak, which highlights the difference between what is presented, something that might, how something might be presented, and what might be the actual reality. And when it comes to Jesus, it looks as if he's been put to death on a cross and left to rot in a grave, end of story. But in fact, our writer says, his death was a sacrifice for our sins, a deliberate act, and he's gone to present that sacrifice in the true Holy of Holies, aka God's actual presence in eternity. So the writer says, we have a great high priest and we have a temple. And the temple that we have is the true temple. The one that the earthly temple of is merely symbolic of. In last week's sermon, I explained how Jesus' priesthood in the order of Melchizedek was more ancient and more venerable than the mainstream Levitical priesthood, because Levi actually honoured Melchizedek even before he was born. And in the same way, The heavenly temple is more ancient and more venerable than that great fantastic earthly counterpart, because, as the writer says, the earthly one, in verse 5, the writer says, the earthly one was patterned on the heavenly one. So he's saying Moses learnt from God about how to build the temple. How did he learn that? Well, he learnt it from, if you like, seeing through to the heavenly one. The heavenly one existed first. Well, how then can we decide which interpretation of Jesus' death is correct? Was he simply executed, or was he offering himself as a sacrifice for our sin? Well, there are two, I think, deciding factors. One, the resurrection. Two, our experience. The resurrection is objective and our experience is subjective. The two go together to help us form our opinions and our beliefs. Now, the resurrection is one of the best attested events of pre-modern history. When I say pre-modern, I mean before the 16th, 17th century. None of the most obvious skeptical explanations add up. And so the best explanations of the resurrection are either that it happened as claimed, or we simply don't know. But none of the other explanations that are sometimes offered really add up. So then we have our subjective experience. When we pray to Jesus, when we intuit his presence, it feels real, not only to us, but to millions of Christians around the world and throughout the generations. That subjective experience then feeds into our objective evaluation of the resurrection claim. We think, which of those two objective options might it be? Might it be that the resurrection happened, as the early Christians said, or might it be that we simply don't know? Well, we know from our own subjective experience that we feel we can talk to a living, breathing, if you like, Jesus. And that feeds back and we think, well, on balance then, maybe that resurrection claim of the early Christians was true. And that is why we intuit and worship and understand and speak with and relate to a living Jesus. It tips the balance. Our subjective experience of knowing Jesus personally tips the balance against we simply don't know. On the contrary, we believe. So what was Jesus' death? The resurrection leads us to interpret his death as a deliberate self-offering, because that's how he himself presented it. Where is Jesus now? His presence here with us leads us to affirm that he's alive with God. How then can we believe that he is truly our great high priest serving in the true temple? It's because of our objective evaluation of the resurrection claim, coupled powerfully with our subjective experience of Jesus' presence now. Right at the start of this series on Hebrews, I said that mainstream Judaism was considered the Rolls-Royce of religion in the ancient world because of its seriousness, because of its antiquity, because of its one God, because of its temple, because of its scriptures. But the argument of Hebrews is that this young offshoot, this radical sect who believes in the crucified Messiah, Christianity, the writer of Hebrews says that this little group is even more authentic, even more ancient, even more venerable, even more the source and origin of all things. And we have therefore access through Jesus to the ultimate temple, the heavenly one, in the very presence of God. Wow, well, that's just a tiny little thought about the temple. We've thought about the priest, the new but ancient priest. We've thought about the new but ancient temple. In part three, we'll think briefly about the new but ancient covenant.
Father, thank you for the snow this week, looking so pretty and so much fun to walk and play out in. Thank you for our cozy homes and the people we live with. Thank you, our country is peaceful and we have enough to eat. Sorry, Father, that sometimes we complain and feel sorry for ourselves, when really you're giving us good things all the time. We pray for the government with the hard decisions they have to make. We pray for good decisions in the next coming days to be made about schools reopening, workplaces restarting, transport and sports and entertainment resuming. Help us to use this time to draw close to you and listen to what you're saying to us. Father, we pray for homeless people on the street in this weather and for effective systems to be put in place to give everyone a place to live where they can rebuild their lives. We think about lonely people, that they will come close to you, find people they can talk to, and some peace in their situations. Father, we pray for the world. We pray first for the situation in Ethiopia, where the federal government is taking possession of the Tigray region in a violent and shocking way. We pray for a swift end to the violence and starvation, and a robust time of letting aid in and rebuilding the region. We pray for people who've been imprisoned, that they will be dealt with fairly. Father, we thank you that Fana, Rahwa, and Saba, all from this church, have all learned that their families are safe now. We pray that Fana's brother, who was attacked, will recover fully, and her sister, who is lost, will be found safe. Father, we pray for peace in Central African Republic, Russia, Yemen, Myanmar, and all the trouble spots in the world. We pray that people will work together to find solutions instead of fighting. And we pray for the many asylum seekers and refugees, that they will be dealt kindly and fairly. Lastly, Father, we pray for an end to COVID-19 in the world. We pray it will end soon and that people will be restored to health and wholeness. We'll say the Lord's Prayer. Dear Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are all yours, now and forever. Amen.
Remember the Lord Jesus, who on the night he was betrayed, he took a piece of bread, he gave thanks to God, he broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in memory of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup and said, "This is God's new covenant, sealed with my blood. Whenever you drink it, do so in memory of me." And that is how much God loves you.
And so to the new covenant, the ancient but new covenant. In verse 6, the writer says that Jesus has arranged a new covenant between God and his people. A covenant is a solemn agreement. In many cases, it's a legally binding agreement. Sometimes if you, again, going back to buying a house or a flat, there might be a covenant on that property saying it must not be used for certain purposes, or it must only be used for certain purposes. A covenant is a solemn agreement, often binding in law. But quoting from the prophet Jeremiah, the writer says that this new covenant that he's talking about has been prophesied several centuries before. So he says it's been arranged by Jesus. He's, if you like, our solicitor who's arranged this covenant, our lawyer, if you like, or our person in high places who has arranged the covenant for us. But in fact, the writer says it was prophesied centuries before. Isaiah was about the 7th century BC. The days are coming, says the Lord, when I will draw up a new covenant with the people. Why was this new covenant needed? Well, Jeremiah goes on to explain in the quotation. They were not faithful to the covenant I made with them, so I paid no attention to them. That's God speaking, of course. Now, think about this. If you have money problems, you might have your debts restructured by the people who you owe money to. Maybe even part of your debts will be written off. Because it's better for everyone if you have a new agreement that might work than if you have an old agreement that won't work. So in place of the old agreement, if you like the old covenant, in place of that old agreement, it's scrapped and a new agreement is put into place in the hope that the new agreement will work even if the old agreement didn't work. This is what Jeremiah said. They were not faithful to the covenant I made with them, so I paid no attention to them. But the days are coming when I will draw up a new covenant with the people. And so that's what Jeremiah is saying. Even though we haven't been faithful to God, he will still set up a new agreement so that we can be faithful. A new agreement that hopefully will work this time. Continue quotation, I will put my laws in their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God. They will know me from the least to the greatest. I will forgive their sins and will no longer remember their wrongs. Now, when the writer of Hebrews looks at the cross and the resurrection of Jesus, he sees a sacrifice made once for all, for all our sins, for the forgiveness of all our sins. He sees that sacrifice presented eternally before the presence of God in the holiest place, not just for one point at one year, but eternally, by an ever-living high priest, Jesus. He sees him there, risen, alive forever, serving in perpetuity. And he realizes, therefore, that this is the new covenant hammered out. Their sins will be forgiven. And of course, he knows of our subjective experience of receiving the Holy Spirit. I will put my laws into their hearts. All we need to do, therefore, is to agree to it. The covenant has been made. The agreement has been arranged. All we need to do is to agree it. It's a sign on the line, if you like. What does agreeing to it actually mean? Let's read the small print. What are the terms? Well, agreeing to the new covenant means these things. Accepting with your mind. Believing in your heart. Confessing with your lips, deciding with your choices, expressing through your life, and following with your ways. A, B, C, D, E, F. Not long ago, I was perusing some retirement properties, and I found myself very taken with one which needed complete and utter renovation. Ruth understandably wasn't so keen, but becoming intoxicated with this dream just for a few hours, I made some inquiries and was eventually ultimately put off when the estate agent let slip that a large part of the building was deemed uninhabitable. Somehow, I could no longer interpret it as an exciting DIY project. It was a step too far. The letter to the Hebrews is all about how we interpret Jesus, his death, his resurrection, his life today in heaven and among us. All the time, the writer is saying things are not as they seem. The atheists might tell you this, but things are not as they seem. People might say, well, Jesus was just 2,000 years ago. Things are not as they seem. He's alive. All the time, the writer is making this argument, but unlike that potential retirement property, Jesus, who looks like an executed failure, is actually the ultimate priest in the ultimate temple, living, presenting the ultimate sacrifice in perpetuity, eternally, before the ultimate altar and the presence of God, in order to forge the ultimate agreement by which our sins are completely forgiven and we have a chance to live with God. So let's not, any of us, shrink back in our faith, but let's see this project through to completion. Amen.
Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and thank you. perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior.
Well, Herod rebuilt the temple and we are rebuilding our community hall. And here are some of the rooms that we're putting in upstairs. There'll be three rooms. You can see some of the framework. I hope that you've enjoyed our online service today and that you've been inspired by the thought of the new covenant which Jesus has arranged for us between us and God, the complete forgiveness, the writing off of our sins and the opportunity of a new life with him. Let's pray as we close. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that we're able to do in your name. We thank you for the temple that was rebuilt in the 6th century BC and indeed the 20 BC that stood as that symbol for the Jewish people, your people, Lord, to draw them together. But we thank you that we have access to a greater, better, eternal temple, the temple of your holy presence in heaven. And thank you that Jesus is there, our great high priest, presenting his sacrifice for our sins each day throughout eternity. So help us to live in the freedom of your forgiveness every day of our lives, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. And don't forget our All Age Extras, which is a separate YouTube program that you can watch now. I hope you enjoy it. See you next time. Bye.